I grew up in Iowa, which is total farm country, and all anybody does there, they work with food. And selling vegetables growing up as a little boy, I was always amazed at why one house would buy everything I had in the wagon, and the other house would look at me like I was carrying kryptonite. And it really sparked this curiosity, you know, why can you take something that the smartest person you know in the world cannot explain why they ate a salad instead of soup this morning, or why they ate one breakfast cereal instead of another. In my lab at Cornell, in the food and brand lab, what's acknowledging is that there's a lot of mindless habits that get formed that can easily be changed, not by education, but by essentially changing the environment. What we find is that there's no right amount to serve yourself. For instance, just the size of a plate, we end up finding that people end up, on average, serving about 22% more pasta on a 12-inch plate than they do on a 10-inch plate. Because what happens, 4 ounces of pasta looks like a full plate on a 10-inch plate. A 12-inch plate, it doesn't even look like an appetizer, so you plop down another big spoonful. But these cues are all around us. How much we serve ourselves are influenced by how much the person right next to served themselves. It's influenced by lighting, it's influenced by the size of a serving spoon. If we don't control these factors, they will almost assuredly nudge us into overeating. Another factor that really messes us up that is going to sound obvious, but it's not obvious what's happening, is the simple convenience of food. What we found is that if you move a candy dish from a person's desk to just 6 feet away, they end up eating 9 candies on the desk. They end up only eating 4 6 feet away. So why'd you eat so much less? Is it because it's hard to walk? They go, no, it has nothing to do with the effort. What it has to do with is that 6 feet gives me pause to ask myself, am I really that hungry? And half the time they'd answer, no. One of the questions is, do we really know when we're full? Now, let me ask you just for a second to think of the last time you were eating dinner, last night. How did you know you were through eating dinner last night?
I said we eat with our eyes and not our stomach. We've done a bunch of cool studies. We used a refillable soup bowl to say that, show that people just basically keep eating food until there's a cue that it's time to stop. We found that when we bring people in, we give them all you can eat wings, chicken wings, then unless there's a visual reminder, let's say the bones, of how much somebody's eaten, they'll be eating about 33% more. But what's more important is at the end of the night, when we have the waitress come back and say, would you care for a free skillet cookie? You know, which has, I don't know, like 13,000 calories. What happens is that if the waitress had left the bones on the table, and a person can remember how much they ate, only about 1 out of 4 people say yes. If those bones have been bust, about 9 out of 10 people say, bring it on. And they're eating the cookie before they get to their car. It's crazy. Some of the greatest public health policies, I think, that would make the biggest difference are not policies that necessarily dictate what people are supposed to do, but they're a policy of a local food service manager who says, by golly, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the healthiest food first. Because kids can then have a better chance to choose that than the pizza, for instance. Or it's the policy that a parent has that says, you know, I want to make sure there's always a fruit bowl sitting on the counter right next to the door and not a potato chip bag. That's a small P policy that a health and wellness group might have to say, you know what we're going to do in this area is we're going to actually extend the time of lunch periods, so the kids have a little bit longer to eat. All of our work on food is focused on behavioral and social sciences, because we don't just show that there's a problem. Every single study we've done and everything the NIH has supported in our life has a solution. We come out with, so here is the solution. You know, we find that, you know, the convenience of foods in some cases influences how much people eat. Here are the easy steps to deconvenience the food. Not to say no to yourself, but to deconvenience it. And I think that's what NIH has helped us do so well, is come up with solution-based research that helps people today. Things they can take home and change tonight as soon as they get back from work. One of the things I've been so grateful for with OBSSR is the fact that they are looking at solutions to things. And it's like the U.S. Department of Agriculture, there's going to be a solution to a problem and not just a different way to describe the problem. That's why I think they are so brilliant and they foreshadow incredible things to come for our nation and our health.